वेलकम, ग्रीटिंग्स। इन टुडेज लेक्चर वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट इंटरेस्ट, इंटरेस्ट रेट्स एंड टाइम वैल्यू ऑफ मनी अनरिलेटेड टॉपिक्स एज पार्ट ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग इकोनॉमिक्स। आई एम Dr. G. Shankara, Professor and Head of the Department, RR Institute of Technology, Bangalore. The contents of the lecture are as below: time value of money, interest rates, simple interest, compound interest, nominal and effective interest rates, cash flow diagram, formula for single payment, formula for equal payments, uniform gradient series, deferred annuities and capitalized cost. All these topics play a very important part of the engineering economics for particularly engineers who are going to enter into the engineering profession, as well as for the practicing engineers and professional engineers. Let us start with the time value of money. Time value of money is generally expressed by interest amount. It is important when one is interested either in investing or borrowing the money. It is very important whenever money is being borrowed or lent, either personally or for your company, for your projects at various levels. Whenever there is a money transaction is involved, understanding of the time value of money plays a very crucial role. This, if a person invests his money today in bank savings, by next year he will definitely accumulate more money than his investment. This accumulation of money over a specified time period is called the time value of money. That means growth in the amount of money with respect to time is called the time value of money, TVM. So it is generally expressed as the interest rate. The original investment or borrowed amount, loan, is known as the principal. So these are the two terms. One is principal, which is the original amount, and another one is the interest, which is the growth over the principal. So if you see the figure, future money is equal to present money plus time. So the time value, if you add to the present value, you will get the future money. The core principle of finance holds that money can earn interest. Growth rate of interest is nothing but growth rate of money, at what rate it will increase, that is the interest. There are five variables that you need to know to understand this time value of money. One is present value. This is your current starting amount. It is money you have in your hand at the present time, your initial investment for future. Then future value. This is your ending amount at a point in time in the future. So in the future, maybe after 1 year, maybe after 10 years, maybe whatever, maybe after some 10 months, whatever money will be in your hand, that is the future amount. It should be worth more than the present value, provided it is earning interest and growing over time. Then number of periods. So this is the timeline for your investment debts. It is usually measured in years, but it could be any scale of time, such as quarterly, monthly, or even daily. So that indicates the timeline, how many periods are involved in calculating the time value. Then interest rate is also growth rate of money over the lifetime of the investment. It is stated in a percentage value, such as 8% or in fractional value as 0.08, it is known as the rate of interest. Interest rate is the cost of using somebody else's money. That is the basically the interest rate. When you borrow money, you pay interest. When you lend money, you earn interest. Interest is additional money that must be repaid. In addition to the original loan balance or deposit, in addition to the principal, interest amount also to be repaid. The amount is usually quoted as annual rate, but interest rate can be calculated for periods that are longer or shorter than 1 year. Time periods can be shorter than 1 year or longer than 1 year. Payment amount. These are the series of equal, evenly spaced cash flows is called payment amount. So, if the interest is paid in equally spaced amounts, or if the interest plus principal is paid instead of a lump sum, paid at regular intervals, those called payment amounts. You can calculate the fifth variable, any four of the five variables listed above are given. So if you know the any four, present value, future value, number of periods, interest rate, payment amount, out of these five, if you know four, using the engineering economics formulas, you can find out the fifth parameter. So that is the represented in the sketch. See, present value is at the left side at the beginning of the time. That is at the time of zero, today. Then every end of the time period, you will get interest is represented by I. So that is added to the present value. So after the end of the time period, finally, you will get the future value. Okay, then, so now you understood what is interest, interest rate. There are basically various types of interest. Two types of interest are simple interest and compound interest. Simple interest is said to be simple when the interest is charged only on the principal amount for the interest period. It is charged, calculated on only the principal amount. No interest is charged on the interest amount accrued during the preceding interest period. That means, for example, if it is calculated every year, so at the end of first year, you will calculate some interest added to the principal. And again, in the second year, interest is calculated on the principal only, not on this interest, like that. So it is basically calculated on the principal only, not on the interest of the previous periods. So how to calculate this interest? Is the IT, is the total amount of interest, is equal to P into N into I. These things you have studied in your high school. So just this is only a revising your memory. P is principal amount, N is number of interest periods, I is the rate of interest. So simple interest reflects the effect of time value of money only on the principal amount. So here an example is also given. Gunant borrowed rupees 3000 from a bank at interest rate of 12% per year for a 2 year period. How much interest rate does he has to pay the bank at the end of 2 years? So here principal is 3000, N is number of periods is 2 years for a 2 year period. Then I is equal to 12%. So interest amount is equal to 3000 into 12% into 2, 720. Then what is the total amount he has to repay because he has borrowed money? So you have to add this interest to the principal amount. So 3000 plus 720, 3720 he has to pay. Then compound interest. Interest rate, interest is said to be compound when the interest for any interest period is charged on principal amount plus the interest amount accrued in all the previous interest period. So here interest is calculated not only on the principal amount but on the interest amount of the previous period. That is the difference between the simple and compound interest. Compound interest takes into account the effect of time value of money on both principal as well as on accrued interest also. The formula for calculating compound interest is, compound interest is equal to the amount of principal and interest in future less principal amount at present. So first you calculate the compound amount. Compound amount means what is the future value is A is equal to P into 1 plus A whole power N will give you the total future value at the end of the periods. So from that, if you deduct the principal amount, you will get the compound interest amount. So P into 1 plus A whole power N minus P. So P into 1 plus A whole power, if you take P common out, is equal to P into 1 plus A whole power N minus 1. So that is the formula for calculating the compound amount as well as compound principal amount, total amount plus compound interest amount. These are the two formulas. Where P is equal to principal, I is equal to nominal annual interest rate in percentage terms, and N is number of compounding periods. So here is an example. Canara Bank has issued a loan of rupees 1000 to a sole proprietor for a period of 5 years. It has given a loan amount, issued a loan for a 5 years. The interest rate for this loan is 5%. This is always expressed per annum, and the interest is compounded annually. Compute the compound amount and compound interest. So compound amount A is equal to P into 1 plus A whole power N, 1000 into 1 plus 5% whole power 5. So while calculating, you should put it in the decimal, 1.05 whole power 5. So it becomes 1276 rupees is the total amount he has to repay at the end of 5 years. So in this, what is the interest amount he is paying? His principal amount is 1000. So compound amount minus principal amount gives you 276 is the interest amount he is paying, compound interest for the 5 years. So now you see, because interest in the compound interest, interest is calculated on the interest of the previous periods also, it is always greater than the simple interest amount. Okay, so that you can see with an example also here. A woman has deposited 6000 in a savings account. Bank pays interest at a rate of 9% per year. Compute the amount of interest rate that will be earned over 12-year period if the interest rate is simple, if the interest rate is compounded annually. So simple interest is equal to I is equal to 6000 into 0.09 into 12, P into I into N. So 6480 she will get at the end of 12 years from the bank if bank is giving simple interest. If the bank is giving compound interest, A is equal to 6000 into 1 plus 9% whole power P into 1 plus A whole power N. So he will get 16878. That means compound interest is amount is 10,878. So if you see, simple interest is getting 6,480, compound interest is getting 10,878. So same thing you can see graph, this red color indicates simple interest and blue color indicates compound interest. So in the beginning, for shorter periods, both I will match almost. Once the number of periods increases, compound interest rate increases exponentially, whereas simple interest grows in the linear fashion. Okay, then if it is so different, we are told the interest periods can be need not be year, it can be monthly, it can be quarterly, it can be half yearly. So in that case, how to calculate? In that formula N, If interest is paid once in a year, n is equal to 1 into y. So number of years you have to put, if it is 5 years, you have to put 5, 1 plus a whole power n. If the interest rate is calculated half yearly, so n becomes 2 into y, means 2 into number of years. If it is 10 years, so your interest is paid half yearly, so n becomes 2 into 10, 20. If the interest is paid quarterly, it becomes n is equal to 4 into y, 4 into 10, 40. So if the interest periods is short, the n becomes more and compound interest becomes more. So that is the calculations. Example, if you see, if you deposit rupees 4000 into an account paying 6% annual interest compounded quarterly, how much money will be the in the account after 5 years? So PF future value is equal to P into 1 plus I whole power n. So 6% annual interest compounded quarterly. So per quarter is 0.06 divided by 4. You have to put here. Quarterly means 4 times in a year. 6% is per annum. So per quarter how much interest rate? 6 by 4, 1.5%. So that is what, 0.06 by 4 whole power, because calculated annually, quarterly 4 times into 5 years. So 4 into 5, 20 you have to put. 4000 into 1.015 whole power 20. So future value is equal to 4000 into 1.34685. So future value becomes 5387.42. So after 5 years there will be 5387.42 in the account. Similarly, if it is compounded monthly, you have to divide the interest rate by 12 and n becomes number of years into 12. That is shown in the next example. How much money would you need to deposit today at 9% annual interest compounded monthly to have 12,000 in the account after 6 years? 12,000 is equal to P into 1 plus 0.09 by 12 whole power 12 into 6. So P into 1.0075 whole power 12. So P is equal to 7,007.08 will be the, you have to get P here. We are calculating P, you know the future value. Okay, you know the future value, you know the interest rate. So we are calculating the how much amount you have to deposit now. So you have to deposit 7,707 rupees for 6 years to get 12,000 at the interest rate of 9% compounded monthly. Okay, so like this, the interest period can be different in different cases, and you can calculate the compound interest using these minor changes in the formulas. Then another important concept in the interest rate is nominal and effective interest rates. This is very tricky and many people get confused in this one. The different types of interest rates, including real, nominal, effective, annual, are distinguished by key economic factors that can help individuals become shrewder investors. Because as you grow in your profession, you have to deal with thousands of crores of rupees. So even a minor variation in the interest rate and number of time periods can make a bigger difference. So you should understand the difference between these various terminology. Nominal interest rate. Nominal interest rate is the stated interest rate of a bond or loan, which signifies the actual monetary price borrowers pay lenders to use their money. If the nominal interest rate on the loan is 5%, borrowers can expect to pay rupees 5 of interest for every 100 loan to them. So that is the actual interest rate being paid. Then what is effective interest rate? The effective rate of interest is the actual amount of interest paid or earned over time after compounding is considered. it is sometimes called the market rate of interest. So what is mentioned or stated will be the nominal rate per annum, but if the compounding period is lesser than annum, then the actual market value per annum will be higher than the nominal rate. So it becomes compounding during the annual period. So the effective interest is calculated as if compounded annually. The effective rate is calculated in the following way, where R is the effective annual rate, I is the nominal rate, and N is the number of compounding periods per year. For example, 12 for monthly compounding. So effective interest rate is equal to 1 plus I whole power N minus 1. If interest rate is compounded annually, both normal and effective will be same. If interest rate is compounded a period lesser than once in a year, then the effective rate, because of its compounding effect, will be higher than the nominal rate. When the frequency of compounding is increased up to infinity, means daily, or if compounding is done every hour or every minute, then this becomes, n becomes infinity, so r is equal to e power I minus 1. The yield depends on the frequency of compounding. So if compounding frequency is increased, the interest amount will become higher. That is what you can see in the table. See, nominal annual rate is 1%. If frequency of compounding is semi-annual, done in twice in a year, then the effect interest rate will be 1.003. If it is done daily, it becomes 1.005. Okay. Similarly, if you see the nominal interest rate, let us say 20%. If you are compounding half yearly, then the effective interest rate will be 21%, market interest rate. And if it is done daily, it becomes 22%. 2% you will be paying more if it is compounded daily in a year. So if the nominal annual rate is 50%, and if it is compounded semi-annual, the effective rate will be 56% per annum. And daily, if you compounding daily, the effective rate will be 64.81 daily per annum. Okay. So these are the various differences between the effective rate and the nominal rate. So most of the lenders, they give generally, they state this is the annual rate, but compound rate different periods. That means the market rate you have to calculate as a effective interest rate. Example, calculate the effective interest rate for a loan with a nominal interest rate of 10% for semi-annual, quarterly, monthly, daily, and continuous compounding. So they say it is 10% flat, but means actually, but when it comes to the effective rate, you will be paying more, or if you are given, you will get more amount. What is that? So if the effective rate of for a semi-annual compounding will be 1 plus 0, 10% is per annum, so 0.1/2 if it is compounding semi-annually, divided whole power 2 minus 1, so it becomes 10.25% per annum. If it is compounded quarterly, then 1 plus 0.1/4 whole power 4 minus 1 becomes 10.38% per annum. Nominal rate is 10%, but effectively you are paying 10.38%. Monthly compounding, 1 plus 0.1 whole power by 12 whole power 12 minus 1, so 10.47%. Daily compounding, it becomes 10.51%. 0.5% is higher per annum. Effective rate interest for continuous compounding will be 10.517%. So these are all the various effective rates based on the compounding period you have to calculate, and then you can understand the difference between the nominal rate and effective rate, which you need to be very careful in accepting the terms and conditions of interest rate when you are borrowing the money from any lender. So here there is an example from a university question paper solved in the same fashion. Okay, you can try this example. Next comes another important concept in the economics in dealing with the finances in personal money or in projects, etc., is the cash flow diagram. When dealing with some financial problems, it is best to describe via some series of a diagram, where it will help you to visualize the problem and shows all inflows and outflows of cash along a timeline. So either in your personal finance or in projects, you will be spending money, that is outflow, and you will be receiving money, inflow. Okay, in your personal finance, for example, monthly you will be getting some, if you are a salaried employee, you will get salary every month. Then you will be spending money for your family expenditure, personal expenditure, then you will be savings, you will be investing. So there will be some money inflow, there will be some money outflow. So if you represent these things in a pictorial form, it will be easy to understand. Similarly, in your projects also, for example, a metro train project. So while constructing, you will be spending so much money. Then once the metro starts, you will be receiving money. And also you are spending money for salaries, for maintenance, for fuel, for electricity bill, all those things. So all these inflows and outflows, if you represent it in a pictorial form, it will be easy to visualize and calculate the various financial parameters. So graphical form. A cash flow diagram had a horizontal timeline. So horizontal line indicates the time, number of time periods. Divided into equal periods such as days, it can be months or it can be years. Here it is shown years, but it can be any. For each cash flow, say some payment or received will be plotted along this line. In a vertical direction, it will be plotted at which it occurs, whether at the beginning or at the end of the period. So whenever cash is flowing out, it will be shown in the down arrow. When cash is coming into your account, it is showing in the up arrow. So this can be at the end of different periods. It is important to understand that funds that you receive, such as proceeds from a mortgage or withdrawals from a saving account or positive cash flows coming into your hand, represents by arrows extending upward from the timeline with their base at the appropriate positions along the timeline. While the funds that you pay out, such as saving deposits or lease payments, are negative cash flows that are presented by arrows which extend downward from the line. Negative sign means money is flowing out your pocket. Positive sign means money is flowing into your account. So if you see this one timeline, at the start of your calculation, time period 0, 1 lakh money is outflow. Okay, then at the end of 3 years, you are getting 35,000 inflow. At the end of fourth year, again 1,15,000 is outflow. Like that, at the end of 10 years, you are receiving 45,000. So these are all the cash flow it represents. The problem is shown here. Consider a mechanical device that will cost $20,000 when purchased. When you have purchased a mechanical equipment for your construction project or for your manufacturing unit or for your electronic industry, whatever it may be, you have purchased a equipment. It costs $20,000. So it is an outflow. So in the beginning, $20,000 is shown at the time 0, out, downward arrow. Maintenance will cost $1,000 each year. So every year you will be spending $1,000 as a maintenance on that equipment. So at the end of every 1 year period, $1,000 is shown in the downward arrow for 5 years. Then after, the device will generate revenues of 5,000 each year for 5 years. So using that equipment, you are doing some work. So it is generating $5,000 per annum every year for 5 years. So that means you are receiving 5,000 because of this equipment. So it is shown in the upward arrow for 5 years. Then after which the salvage value is expected to be $7,000. The cash flow diagram is shown. So at the end of 5 years, in addition to the regular 5,000, the scrap value or salvage value, you are getting additional $7,000. That is the cash flow diagram. Same thing can be represented in a simplified. Here what we are doing, instead of showing both upwards, we are showing at the end of time period net flow. Total net flow means cash outflow plus inflow. Then net flow also you can show. So 5,000 is inflow, 1,000 is outflow. So net flow is 4,000. So you can show only that one and prepare the cash flow diagrams. Both ways it can be represented. Now, compound interest factors we will see, because there are different calculations. We have seen what is the simple interest, what is the compound interest. And we have seen there are different terminology: present value, future value, payment amounts. So if to calculate this present value, future value, payment amounts, there are some factors are developed based on the situation. So using that formulas and using the tables are also available for that. Using the tables, you can calculate the amounts easily. Let us see how. Compound interest factors. So you know these terms we already described. P is the present worth, F is the future worth, A is the uniform annual worth, means every year uniformly how much amount either you have to pay or you will receive. N is the number of interest periods. Again, remember it can be years or months or quarterly or daily, like that. I is the rate of interest per year or per month. Now, so those things again shown in the cash flow diagram. As you discussed earlier, the inflows are shown in the upward, that is all. Outflows are shown in the downward arrow. And also the rate of interest also should be mentioned in the cash flow diagram. So basically there are three terms as you see. One is present value of money, what is in your hand today. Next is what is the future value you are going to get or pay. Then annual series, if you are paying instead of a lump sum every year some amount, or if you are receiving some amount, then that is called annual series. So these are all the three basic values of the money which we come across in this engineering economic calculations. So to find these relationships between these, there are some formulas are developed. To find the relationship between P and F, means if you know the lump sum, if you know the present value of money so much, what will be the future value? If you know the future value you want so much in future, what is the present value you have to put? So relationship between P and F are called as single payment factors. Only once they are paid, that is called single payment factors. Whereas relationship between P and A, A and P, F and A, A and F. So A is an annual series, means every year the money will be coming or going. So that is called a annual equal payment series. So these are all the different calculations which we will look into now. Okay, so single payment series, as I told, is relationship between P and F. So single payment compound factor. That means you know the P. You are investing so much money now. You know the interest period. You know the rate of interest. Then how much will be the future value? Or if you have borrowed some amount for so many years at this so much interest rate, how much you have to pay? So single amount you have taken or paid only once, present and future, no in between payments. So that is the F is equal to P into 1 plus A whole power N, relationship between F and P. So it is also generally represented with the notation F is equal to P into F by P I N. That means what here? You know P, you know I, you know N, you have to calculate P. F, you have to calculate the F. So the term in the bracket is called the single payment compound factor. So if you multiply the P with that factor, you will get the F. Tables are available or formula is available to calculate that factor. The notation in parenthesis can be read as follows. To find the future sum F, a given present sum P at interest rate I per interest period and N interest period. So very simple to understand, you see. You know P, I, N, you have to calculate F. That is what shown in the parenthesis. So that is a factor which you multiply with P, you will get the F. Example, $100 is invested at 6% interest per year, compounded annually. Then the future value of this amount after 4 years is equal to P into, that is the formula, P into 1 plus A whole power N. So 100 into 1 plus 0.06 whole power 4 becomes 126.25 is the future value of your present investment. So these are all single, you are invested single one time and you are getting one time, called single payment factor, the relationship between P and F. Then single payment present worth factor. In this case, you know the future amount, you require so much amount. How much you have to invest now? Present value, how much you have to invest? Okay. So that is called here the relationship, the notation is P is equal to F into P by F comma I comma N. That means you know F, you know I, you know N, you have to calculate P. So the formula is P is equal to F into 1 by 1 plus I whole power N. Reverse of the previous, inverse of the earlier calculation. Okay, same thing is shown in the sketch. F is known. Okay, number of periods N is known, rate of interest is known, P is the unknown. So you have to calculate. So this is called the single payment present worth factor, SPPWF. So these are all the two relations between present and future worth. So an example is also given. A company is expecting to receive $5,000 4 years from now. Compute present value of this sum if the current market interest rate is 10% and interest is compounded annually. So future value is 5,000 F, rate of interest is 10.1, N is 4. So if you have substitute, you will get P is equal to 3,415. That means to get a 5,000 rupees in the future after 4 years, has a present value of 3,415. Next comes the uniform payment series. So that is the relationship between P and A and F and A. First we will see the relationship between P and A and A and P. So uniform series present worth factor. That means if you annually you have to get so much amount, how much amount you have to deposit. or if you have borrowed so much amount now, annually including principal plus interest, how much you have to pay. Okay, so if you see the notation, you know A, annual amount, how much you are paying or you have to receive. I, you know, N, you know, you have to calculate P. So the formula is P is equal to A into 1 plus I whole power N minus 1 by 1 plus I whole power N. So if you see the sketch also, P is unknown, A at the end of every year amount, you know, then how to calculate P. Okay. So if you see example, how much money would you be willing to pay now for a guaranteed $600 per year for 9 years starting next year at a rate of return 16% per annum? So let us say you need from next year onwards every year some $600 to meet your additional expenditure, maybe because of your education of your children, whatever it may be. Then how much money you have to save in the bank now to get $600 every year in future for 9 years at the rate of 16%. So using this above formula, if you substitute all these values, you will get P is equal to 2,764. So if you deposit 2,764 now, you will get every year 600 per next 9 years. Then inverse. So if you know P, you know I, you know N, capital recovery factor, how much A you will get. Okay, so this is the, you all know, see if you see notation, P you know, I you know, N you know, how to calculate A. The same shown in this sketch, P is known, A is unknown, you have to calculate A. It generally is to find out the uniform annual amount of a uniform series from the note. That means if you are taking a loan from a bank, okay, to buy your car or to buy a house, a flat, you have taken some 10 lakhs, 20 lakhs, 50 lakhs, 1 crore. So including interest and principal, how much amount EMI. This is mainly to calculate the EMIs. This formula you can be used. The formula is inverse of that. A is equal to P into I into 1 plus I whole power N by 1 plus I whole power N minus 1. So we have seen the relationship between P and A. Next we have to see the relationship between F and A. Okay. So future amount and the annual series. So if you deposit every year so much amount, in the end how much amount you will get. Similarly, if you have to get so much amount in the end, how much every period you have to save. So that is the relationship between uniform series, compound amount factor. That means if you are saving every year so much amount, finally F, how much you will get. So A you know, F you don't know. Okay, so notation is F is equal to A into F by A comma I comma, whatever is known will be shown after the slash in the bracket. So A, I know, I, N you know, F you have to calculate. So that factor is F by A, I. So formula for that is 1 plus I whole power N minus 1 by I. For example, see, you deposited 200 at the end of every year for 7 years. So from your salary, you are saving, let us say, per annum $200. So you want to save in the bank at an interest rate of 6% for 7 years. You want to take that money at the end of 7 years to buy something. So how much you will get money? So you can calculate using this factor. So the factor is 1.0 minus 1 by, so that becomes 8.3938. So 1,679 dollars you will get if you depositing $200 every year for 7 years. So a university question is also solved in the same problem.
then sinking fund factor. That means F is known. So you have to get so much amount in the end, then how much money you have to save or deposit now. So you are planning to buy or a flat after 10 years which cost you 1 crore. So instead of borrowing from the bank now, you want to save your money and want to buy with your own money, then how much money you have to save every year. Okay, the sinking fund factor is used to calculate the annual amount A of a uniform series for the known future sum. Okay, or you are for your retirement, you want at the end of retirement, you want 60 years, let us say you are going to retire. So at the end of retirement, you want some 1 crore amount in your hand. So you will want to save the money. Now you are at the age of, let us say, 40. For the next 20 years, you want to save the money every year. How much money you have to save for 20 years at this interest rate? Such calculations can be using this formula. So here, A is unknown. F is known. So it is inverse of the previous problem. So it becomes A is equal to F into A by F I comma N or Z comma N interest rate. So F into I by 1 plus I whole power N minus 1. That is called the sinking fund factor. Suppose you want exactly 1600 at the end of 7 years in an account that earns 6% annual effective interest. By using the sinking fund factor, calculate the necessary annual amount you would need to deposit. You have to send your children for a higher education at the end of, after, now let us say he is around 13 years. So at the end of 20 years, you want to, if he, once he completes his bachelor's degree for higher education, you want to send him to abroad. He needs so much amount. So every year now, how much you have to save? Such calculations can be done. An example from the university question paper is also solved, which you can practice. So now we have seen the relationship between the PF, P and F, F and P, P and A and P, F and A and F. There is another few more variations are there. One is uniform gradient series, annual equivalent amount. So what is this? In this case, in the previous case, we have seen equal amounts. We are saving or depositing every year. Here, instead of equal amount every year, he has to increase, one wants to increase that amount by equal amount every year. That means, let us say, you are, because your salary will be increasing every year, let us say 10% every year. So, you, instead of saving the same 1000 rupees per every year, you want to save, you want to increase that amount by 100 rupees every year. So first year you want to save 1000, second year you want to save 1100, third year you want to save plus 100, 1200, next year 1200 plus 100, 30, like that every year you want to increase it by an amount G. So if you are increasing that amount by an equal amounts, then how to calculate the future values, present values and annual. So that is shown here. Okay. So first what you have to do is that G you should calculate, convert it into A. Once you convert that into A, then you can calculate P and F using those formulas. So formulas are given in this case. Okay. So that is about the various compounding factors which one will come across in their personal finance or in their professional finance, investment or expenditures. There are some more terms like deferred annuity. What is annuity? Annuity means A. What we have calculated in the example, annuity means A, which is calculated at the end of each period. annual period. That is called annuity. So annuity is a series of regular, equally spaced payments over a definite period of time, often called the term at a constant rate of interest. Payments may occur weekly, fortnightly, month. So at the end of equal periods, if you are doing some transactions, that is called the annuity. Example, house rent, you are paying every month. Mortgage payments, your housing loan payments. Installment payments on automobiles. Interest payments on money invested. All these comes under as annuity. Annuities are classified into four categories. These are ordinary annuity, annuity due, deferred annuity, and perpetuity. So these are all the four types of annuity one will come across. What is ordinary annuity? Ordinary annuity will equal payments are made at the end of each compounding period, starting from the first compounding period. That means if you are taking, let us say, loan in August, this is now, let us say, today is June 29th. Let us say you are taking the loan on July 1st. Okay, some 10 lakhs to buy a car, you are taking a loan on July 1st. So when in your EMI will start? Bank say your EMI will start from the August 1st. You are taking July 1st. So at the end of the first monthly period, you have to pay the amount, EMI. That is called the ordinary annuity. It starts immediately after taking or payment of the principal. That is called the, so that is what's shown in the graph. So payment are received at the end of each period immediately after taking the or paying the amount. Then what is deferred annuity? In deferred annuity, this payment period is delayed by certain number of periods. That means, for example, you are taking a, that's what, if you see educational loan, for example, you will be taking the loan, let us say, for your engineering program, 4 years, you will get the loan at the end of first year, or first in the beginning to pay the fees, then in the first year, at the end of first year, at the end of second year, or in the beginning of second year, like that, 4 years you will receive the educational loan. But when you have to start paying, actually bank will give you 1 more year also extra to have a job and to settle some of your other expenditure, your house rent, other minor. Then they say after the job you receive, after 1 year or 2 years you can start pay. Not immediately in the first year of your engineering course. Even though you have taken the fees in the first year, you need not pay the EMIs in the first year itself. So whatever loan you have taken in the first year of your engineering, you will start be paying after 5 years. So your payment is delayed by certain amount of time. That is called deferred annuity. Your annuity is deferred by certain periods. So that is what it is shown here. See, you are taking the amounts at 0, 1, 2, etc. Then your payments will start at the end of D plus 1, D plus 2, like that. So that is called the deferred annuity. So how to calculate that different annuities is what we will do. So this different annuity, you see D plus 1, D plus 2, etc. They are at regular intervals. So you will consider it as A and calculate P at the beginning of D plus 1. You know relation between P and A. So using that P and A formula, calculate the present value at the D plus 1 period for the various payments. Then that present value becomes future F for the actual present value which you are paying. P and F or A and F. So from that you can calculate the initial amount. So using that, the principles which you have studied earlier between relationship between A and F, P and A, using those principles, you can calculate the deferred annuity amounts. Using the formula also is given, P deferred is equal to P into 1 plus A whole power minus D is equal to R into 1 minus I. All these formulas you can use and you can calculate. Example, there are a pension plans in which annuity starts after a certain date. It can be further divided into the following. For example, you want a pension plan, means you will retire at the 60. So you want, instead of a lump sum from the bank, you want every year so much as a pension. Then for that, at the from your 30 years or 40 years age, you will start investing. So you are not receiving the returns immediately. You are receiving the payments after you retire 60. So your annuity is deferred. So such cases, so it has various phases. Accumulation phase. It is the phase when you start investing and accumulating cash, and commences from the date when you first time pay premium. That is called accumulation, when you are paying and investing the money in the pension plan. Vesting phase. It is the date from which you will start getting the policy benefits in the form of pension. Then you won't pay any amount. You will get the your principal plus interest, what you have paid till that period. Then that is in the vesting phase, you will get the amount back. That is called a deferred annuity. This happens even in case of our projects also. For example, that's why, as I told you are constructing a metro project. So it will be 10 years period, the construction phase will be. So every year you will be investing money. Then after 10 years, once the operation of the metro starts, then in the form of revenues, you will get the amount back every year. So that is how the finance, who provides finance to the metro projects like IMF, World Bank, or big banks, which finances the metro projects, they will calculate their deferred annuities, because they will not get the amount immediately. They have to give the loan every year. Once project is completed, they will be getting the revenue. Okay. Then another important in this annual payments, etc., is the capitalized cost. Okay. So a cost is money paid to obtain an asset, whereas an expense represents monetary value leaving the company. There is a difference between cost and expenses. Expense means which you spend, like salaries, current bill, rent, all these things. Whereas cost means if you are spending money to acquire an asset, then it is called a cost. If you spend $5,000 money to pay wages or rent, the $5,000 will likely to go on income statement as an expense. But if you use the money to pay for an asset that will remain with the company, the $5,000 will likely to go on the balance sheet as a capitalized cost. Which you spend for the acquiring the assets is called the capitalized cost. It refers to the present worth of mainly cost or expenditures of the alternative over infinite period of time. Particularly if the duration is infinite period, then it is called as capitalized cost. Capitalized worth refers to the present worth of expenditures and revenues of an alternative over infinite periods of time. So particularly if you see civil engineering, certain projects like dams, flyovers, bridges, they stay for a infinite period of time. So how much money you will be spending over those things every year, how much money you will be getting as a revenue, all this you will convert into a single amount in the beginning. That is called the capitalized cost. So you have to use the following formula to actually we have to use the present worth of a uniform amount series, because your expenditures will be every year either in the form of spending or maintaining or repairing, etc. So what will be the present amount totally you will be spending on that project if you want to calculate? That is called P is equal to you will be using the present worth of uniform. P and A relationship you have to use actually. But because so N is infinite, that is what here main concept in capitalized cost is, N is our infinite period of time dam. If you see Mysore Brindavan dam, it is constructed maybe 70 years or 100 years back, still it is working. Maybe another 50, if you get repair and all those things, another 50, 100 years. So it's a very long duration. So N becomes infinite. So if you simplify this formula and substitute, instead of N, if you substitute infinity for N, then this formula, you know, that becomes P is equal to A by I. Very simplified calculation you will get. That means the annual amount divided by the rate of interest will give you the directly the capitalized cost. The above expression can be explained by a simple example. If a person deposits an amount of, similarly people do some investment like a prize money, okay, you want to, you become rich tomorrow, you want to pay some scholarships to a student in your college forever. So what college will say, every year we don't know where you will be, how much money you will be, all those. So you invest some amount at this interest rate. So whatever interest is we are getting, we will pay every year as a scholarship, perpetual. So how much amount you have to deposit for that? So such calculations also comes as capitalized cost. Let us see example. If a person deposits an amount of 1 lakh in a bank at interest rate of 10% per year, how much money the person can withdraw from the bank every year without reducing the original deposit? Amount of interest accumulated, the person can without reducing the deposit at the end of first year is 1000. 10% of 1 lakh is 1000. So every year you can withdraw 1000. 1 lakh will be there in the bank as it is. So that 1000 you can give as a endowment prize or scholarship or some gift to some old age people like that. After withdrawing 1000, 10,000 at the, so every month you are 1000 you are drawing. So at the end of, in 1 year you will be drawing 10,000, but your 1 lakh will be as it is. Again next year you will get the amount same. So this is the calculation of the compound capitalized cost. So these are all the various terminology we use in the